This is an original memorial lithograph of President William McKinley, his wife Ida, and mother Nancy. Printed in 1901, it was in very poor condition, and we gave it an archival poster fix. Hi, I'm Chris, and welcome to Poster Fix Studio. Today we have a very beautiful memorial lithograph from the year 1901. It presents President William McKinley, his wife, Ida Saxton McKinley, and his mother, Nancy. It was printed soon after his assassination. This print is a clay-coated poster and brought some interesting complications with it in the process of linen backing. Today you're going to see how we handle this process. Take a look.
Well, I've got this lithograph of President William McKinley in very poor condition with his, probably his wife and mother. So I'm going to linen back this to try to save it.
William McKinley was the 25th president of the United States, serving from March 4, 1897 until his assassination on September 14, 1901, after leading the nation to victory in the Spanish-American War and raising protective tariffs to promote American industry.
The lithographic quality of this is beautiful. I'm spraying it with water to help it expand. This is also clay-coated paper, so I'm going to be careful with its surface.
At the 1896 Republican Convention, in time of economic depression, the wealthy Cleveland businessman Marcus Alonzo Hanna ensured the nomination of his buddy William McKinley as the advance agent of prosperity.
So to protect the clay coating, I'm going to cover it before I roll it out. Now, using a roller, I'm pushing out the air pockets and the excess wheat paste between this lithograph and the acid-free paper that is behind it. I've already lined up the two sheets. They look pretty good. Now, this clay coating is what makes the paper look white. Clay coating can easily be rubbed off if one puts too much aggressive sponge action on it. And the clay coating is what the lithograph is printed onto, so we don't want the clay coating to get rubbed off. So I'm going to try to avoid putting a lot of washing on this print. I'm going to dab it with the sponge.
The Democrats, advocating the free and unlimited coinage of both silver and gold, which would have mildly inflated the currency, they nominated William Jennings Bryan. President McKinley was born in Niles, Ohio in 1843. He went to Allegheny College, and he enlisted in the Civil War. He was teaching in a country day school when the Civil War broke out, and he enlisted.
So we've got this President McKinley lithograph from 1901. Linen back. This was printed by the International Art Company Publishers, St. Charles, Illinois. Copyright 1901, Edwards and Deutsch and Heitman, Chicago. God's will, not ours, be done. His last words. This commemorates his birth and death. He was assassinated in 1901.
So we're going to let this litho dry for a few days. After it dries, these dark spots will lighten up a bit, and whatever it doesn't lighten up, we can go in and do touch-up, and we will make McKinley look like he's come back to life. You won't want to miss that, so don't go away.
Incidentally, this lithograph of President McKinley was probably printed with limestone plates as opposed to zinc plates because of the quality of the lithography and the portraiture, the fine gradating of the lights and shadows. It's printed, or copyright rather, in 1901 by Edwards, Deutsch, and Heitman.
I'm now preparing the poster to have paper fills put around the edges where the paper is missing. We're going to use paper pulp in those areas. After serving in the Civil War, William McKinley opened up a law practice in Canton, Ohio, and married the daughter of a successful banker by the name of Ida Saxton. They had two daughters, both of which died young. At 34, McKinley won a seat in Congress. During his 14 years in the House, he became the leading Republican tariff expert, giving his name to the measure enacted in 1890. The next year, he was elected governor of Ohio, serving two terms. When McKinley became president, the Depression of 1893 had almost run its course, and with it, the extreme agitation over silver. He called Congress into special session to enact the highest tariff in history. Ida has somewhat of a sad story in terms of her health. His wife was already an invalid by the time she moved into the White House. Ida Saxton McKinley served as First Lady of the United States from 1897 to 1901, and there was little resemblance between the young, vivacious, and fashionable young girl he married and the invalid that he eventually brought with him to the White House. Only one thing had remained the same: love. Ida had been born in Canton, Ohio in 1847, elder daughter of a socially prominent and well-to-do family. We have completed the paper fill work in the restoration, and when we come back, you're going to see us do the inpainting, touch-up, and completion of this lithograph. You won't want to miss that, so don't go away.
At Poster Fix, we like to restore vintage posters, vintage prints, lithographs. We can do many other kinds of things like maps and newsprint and things like that. So if you have any posters or other kinds of paper ephemera that you'd like us to look at and restore for you, send me an email. Tell me what they are. Tell me their size, condition, and send me a few photos, and I'll get back to you with a price for restoration and conservation work. I look forward to seeing what you have.
In the friendly atmosphere of the McKinley administration, industrial combinations developed at an unprecedented pace. Newspapers caricatured McKinley as a little boy led around by Nursey Hanna, the representative of the trusts. However, McKinley was not really dominated by Hanna. He condemned the trusts as, quote, dangerous conspiracies against the public good. Well, how did the media respond to Ida Saxton McKinley being an invalid in the White House? Well, they didn't say much. They kept it a secret. At least they didn't mention it. At any rate, Oki is using water-reversible gouache to brighten up the white areas of the border and to put in color to make those paper fills match. At the White House, the McKinleys acted as if her health were no great handicap to her role as First Lady. Richly and prettily dressed, she received guests at formal receptions seated in a blue velvet chair. She held a fragrant bouquet to suggest that she would not shake hands. Contrary to protocol, she was seated beside the president at state dinners, and he, as always, kept close watch for signs of an impending seizure. If necessary, he would cover her face with a large handkerchief for a moment. The First Lady and her devoted husband seemed oblivious to any social inadequacy. Guests were discreet and newspapers silent on the subject of her fainting spells. Only in recent years have the facts of her health been revealed. When the president was shot by the assassin in September of 1901 after his second inauguration. He thought primarily of her. He murmured to his secretary, quote, "My wife, be careful, for tell you how you tell her, oh, be careful." After his death, she lived in Canton, cared for by her younger sister, visiting her husband's grave almost daily. She died in 1907 and lies entombed beside the president and near where their two little daughters in Canton's McKinley Memorial Mausoleum. Here's a little bit more about Ida. Being pretty fashionable and a leader of the younger set in Canton did not satisfy Ida, so her broad-minded father suggested that she work in his bank. As a cashier, she caught the attention of Major William McKinley, who had come to Canton in 1867 to establish a law practice. And they fell deeply in love. While he advanced in his profession, his young wife devoted her time to home and husband. A daughter, Catherine, was born on Christmas Day of 1871, a second in April of 1873. This time, Ida was seriously ill. The frail baby died in August. I'm using watercolor pencils to fill in the areas of missing color in the rips and creases. It can be said that foreign policy is really what drove McKinley's administration, the Spanish-American War. Reporting the stalemate between Spanish forces and revolutionaries in Cuba, newspapers screamed that a quarter of the population was dead and the rest suffering acutely. Well, that was a big exaggeration. Public indignation brought pressure upon the president for war. Unable to restrain Congress or the American people, McKinley delivered his message of neutral intervention in April of 1898. Congress thereupon voted three resolutions tantamount to a declaration of war for the liberation and independence of Cuba. In the 100-day war, the United States destroyed the Spanish fleet outside Santiago Harbor in Cuba, seized Manila in the Philippines, and occupied Puerto Rico. In 1900, McKinley again campaigned against William Jennings Bryan. While Bryan inveighed against imperialism, McKinley quietly stood for the full dinner pail. His second term, which had begun auspiciously, came to a tragic end in September of 1901. McKinley was standing in a receiving line at the Buffalo Pan American Exposition when a deranged anarchist shot him twice. He died 8 days later. William McKinley signed the open door policy for China, which sought to safeguard U.S. trading rights in China and asserted American interests in Asia. Signaling an alliance with organized labor workers, McKinley signed the Dingley Tariff of 1897, which authorized reciprocal trade treaties. The Dodge Commission evaluated and reformed the organization of the army, resolving bimetallism and currency issues. The Gold Standard Act of 1900 formally placed U.S. money on the gold standard. The Paris Treaty of 1898 resolved the Spanish-American War, and the United States obtained Puerto Rico, Guam, and, for $20 million, the Philippine Islands.
You have to do
this
more pencil here.
Okay.
Okay.
Then here. Here.
William McKinley proved to be a forceful executive, acting as a forerunner for the modern presidency in asserting pressure on Congress to support his policies. Under McKinley's governance, the United States emerged as a colonial power. Well, that about wraps it up for the restoration of this lithograph of President William McKinley, the 25th President of the United States, who was a tariff man. Yes, he believed in tariffs to protect American industry. So anyway, take care, and remember, at Poster Fix, we love to bring your vintage posters back to life.